This is Dr. Gregory Jenkins. We're returning after our break, and we're here with I'm here with Dr. Kurtz, Judith Kurtz, a clinical certified sexologist, and we're at KHTS 1220 AM. The phone number here is 661-298-5487. During the break, we were you know, reliving some of the conversation we had earlier about how do you talk to your partner about sexual preferences? How do you say, I want you to try this, I want you to try that? So I think the level of the relationship has to be deep for that to happen. So as soon as you hit that deeper part of the relationship and it's not a date type of sex thing, you'll be able to figure it out. So probably more discussion, less action will probably help.
You know, I think that's more common than we realize. We think people who are couples can talk to each other, but they really don't that much. And sometimes, and oh, here's a caution, if your partner wants to tell you, gosh, I'd really like this or that, whatever it is, don't shut them down. Listen to them. And it may not be something that you're interested in, you've ever tried, but it might be a good idea, if there is trust in the relationship, that you try. The book that came out in the movie, 50 Shades, I mean, that sent people over the top about what they wanted. It was not at all about abuse. We do not like abuse. It is unacceptable. No one should feel abused in a relationship. However, you can talk about fun things, kind of sparking up a relationship that's been around. But I think the most important thing is when someone gets up the nerve, and I think it's very, very difficult to get up the nerve and say to your partner, gosh, this turns me on. I'd really like this. And then they shut you down and say, what's wrong with you? What a horrible thing. And both of you lose there. So be open. Listen. I don't think much is too kinky or too sick. There's fun things that people can do. And truly, if you're having difficulty communicating with each other, it might be good to go to a sex therapist because, wow, it's fun in there. And it is, I think, worth every penny because we'll open the conversation and I'll bring up things that you're kind of afraid to say, because I have a lot of people sighing like, oh, good, somebody brought this up. And I think we have to be mature about it and respectful about it in our relationships. There's sometimes things that one person is totally opposed to, and then we have to work out how everyone gets their needs met. It's a lot easier than you think. What I've always said is keeping things inside is probably the worst thing that you can do. I think, I don't know, when I was growing up in the olden days, you were told to be quiet, don't talk about things, don't ask questions. And that's the antithesis of what we should be doing. We should be asking questions. We should be talking. Because if we don't talk, it makes us sick. It depresses us. It makes us angry and resentful. And that's no way to live, folks. That's no way to live. So we have to be able to have conversations.
Well, you know, I'm back to the millennials again, because, you know, in some of those dating sites they have questions, what you like to do, what do you prefer, and things like that. And maybe people my age should be asking those kind of questions too. You know, the exactly what wants to be done. And, you know, we're talking about, you know, cold weather, and sometimes the word frigid comes up, but I don't think anybody's really frigid and they can't enjoy sexual relationships. But it's hard to get to that point where you're relaxed enough with that person to try different things and move forward in a relationship. If that doesn't work, that's fine. There's other things that you can try.
Exactly, exactly. And no, frigid is not a word. I'm so glad you said that. There really aren't frigid people around, or I think that's been used primarily towards women than it is for men, being frigid. Mm-hmm. Not interested? Well, maybe there's a reason. Let's talk about it. Let's get down to what the real issues are, because there's always something, and we always get there. So, you know, I don't think in 25 years I've ever had a hopeless couple or a hopeless relationship. We've always been able to work through some things. It may not be exactly the answer you want, but we can always work through it if you're willing to and if you're being open enough.
That's exactly right. I think what you find sometimes is that, you know, there have to be experimentation in relationships, and each of these experiments, they're going to be good for you, they're going to be bad for you, but if you try them, you'll find out, you know. And certain, you know, sometimes patients come to me, the men, I should say, come to me, and they're looking for some help with sexual relations, and they're always thinking that, oh, my testosterone needs to be checked, and if it's too low, then I need to have testosterone shots, or if the testosterone is normal, I need to headache medicines like Viagra and Levitra and Cialis to help them. But that's usually not what the problem is. The problem, if they have low testosterone, that's still not what's causing the problems. And so they'll try one of those kind of pills and hope that makes things better. But really, it's not the medicine. It's not the low testosterone. Really, it's the relationship that needs to be cured.
And I think one of the key issues, we talk about low T and high T, talking about testosterone. Well, I think the low T issue, which would be trust, if you don't have much trust in your partner, that is not much intimacy, then you really don't have a relationship. And, you know, maybe you work on that. I don't think relationships are hopeless. Sometimes they do come to the end of the road where, well, we have to go our separate ways just so we can be happy. And, you know, I think in this lifetime we all need to be happy, don't we? I mean,
happiness is wonderful. I think, like I say, when I see some of the men in the office, they just think, if I can just have good sex with my wife, then we'll be happier. And it's not the sex that makes happiness. It's part of the relationship, but it's not the things, you know. And you were talking to Dr. Kurtz earlier about there's no Viagra for women. It's so hard to find a way to test and see if a medicine works for women because there's no tissue that's available to test it on.
And when I said it starts in the head and the heart and being valued, I mean, looking at your partner, looking at a woman and being close to her, talking to her, like you're really interested, not like this is what I want and, you know, here's the way it is. I think you've really got to talk and act as if, not act as if, I'm so sorry, forgive me for that. Really care. And if you don't really care, you're not doing anybody a favor.
I think, Dr. Kurtz, you're hit right on top of that there. So I think that I think we have to encourage the relationships to expand. And like you said, sometimes people just don't get along. You're not going to be happy with whatever experiment you do. So sometimes you have to get to a point with a therapist that you can say, okay, this is not, it's not working, so we might as well get this over with. But the problem with the breakups is they're so emotional. And really, it's, you know, it's more like a business decision that you're going to have to split things up and move on and, you know, and make a different life. But then there's the problem with the children. If you have children, is that what do you do with the children? And then so it's a lot of negotiations that have to be done. And hopefully they're all done just, you know, business-like, and there's not a lot of anger. But that's a hope. You know, there's a lot of anger and a lot of divorces, and, you know, cost the couples a lot more money than they should have.
Well, I think, too, the one thing that we're doing wrong in our country is expectations. When we get married, we think, or when we enter into a partnership with someone, we have these expectations that it's going to be magical. We're going to have amazing sex. We're going to have amazing conversations. And our expectations aren't really verified. We have to work on that and start talking and talk about ourselves quite a bit and say, this is important to me. This is what I want to do. And couples today, my goodness, you know, they're working, they have children, we have two income. I used to see groups that I called DINS, D-I-N-S, and that's double income, no sex. And they would come to me, and it's something that you can work through, but you really have to want to. And, you know, one thing that I would like to talk about, kind of a segue, I'd like to talk about menopause. And because we have the medical part of that, hormones do play a part. Women will come and think, well, you know, I'm in menopause, therefore I don't like sex, don't want sex, it's hormonal. What physically do you see about menopause that gets in the way of healthy sexuality?
The truth is that the main thing that gets in the way with menopause is lack of vaginal lubrication. So there are plenty of prescription medicines and non-prescription medicines that can help with that. Because if it's dry, then it's painful for the partner, and it's not easy to have a relationship that way. So, you know, many times we can order blood tests that shows how far you into menopause. But the truth is, the same problem. It's dryness.
Well, I think, too, for a woman to be able to say that to her partner, once again, she feels shame. Oh, my goodness, I'm not feminine now. I'm not this. I'm not that. I've lost my femininity. Truth is, after menopause, you can be the hot self you were when you were 18, if you want to be, and if you have a great partner, you can certainly do that. You may need some help, some medication. And does it take longer to get excited for men and for women after menopause or manopause or whatever we want to call it? Yes, it does. And so why not enjoy that time? And I also want to give a bit of information, and I hope if there are any men listening, please listen to this, or women, you can tell your partners that Dr. Kurtz said this. It takes women at least 20 minutes to really get excited. You see on TV and on the movies that everybody is, you know, wiggling and writhing and everything is so exciting, but you know what? Not reality. Men have seen photos of women, and we're really lying to people. It takes women at least 20 minutes to get excited and to get into the experience. So, I mean, if you don't have 20 minutes for your relationship, that's not a good thing. I'm sure you can find that somewhere. You can find 20 minutes to do a lot of things. Have a beer, to watch a TV show, email, text. I think you can find 20 minutes or more for this relationship that's supposed to make you happy and healthy and keep you from having a heart attack. Isn't that cool?
That's great. I think that we should try to, you know, cut out 20 minutes. But, you know, I like to change a little bit. We talked about Viagra a little bit, but there are some over-the-counter supplements that some men take that could help them if they want to try that. And those are usually sold in the vitamin stores, and they're usually gone along the names of them are things that are for male health, like not a female, but a male health formula. And they have medicines in it to make the prostate work better, and prostate's important for secretions. And also there's nitric acid, not nitro acid, but nitric with a C. And those are as a vasodilator, so it opens up the arteries and veins in the penis so that it gets more engorged with blood. So some people try those also.
I think that's wonderful. Yeah. I think that's such great information. People really don't know about these things. There's so many things that we want to talk to you about here in Santa Clarita and to help you with your relationship. Studies are showing that couples who have better sex can get through tough times, because we're all going to have tough times, can get through tough times when they are having better sex. It keeps you closer. It keeps you happier and healthier, much more active.
That's true. I think that, you know, sometimes we see these movies of end of the world movies. And, you know, what you see, though, is usually the couples come together in a tense time like that. The world's going to blow up. Something's going to happen bad. And there's always people hugging each other.
Right. They're used to clinging to each other.
Right.
And that's a very nice feeling. So I'm wondering, do we have a call? Hello, is this Cindy?
Yes, hi.
Hi, Cindy, how are you?
Fine, thank you. I have a question. Okay. I have an issue with my husband where he's always wanting sex, and for me, it's just not possible, or I just don't have it in me to do it, and his libido is way higher than mine, and I don't. And then he gets upset or feels rejected if I don't comply. So I was wondering if you had any advice about that.
Cindy, I wish you knew how many times I've heard this, and it's a serious story that men think many times that if they have sex, it feels good, that will solve all the problems, but then apparently you're carrying a lot of issues that you haven't talked to him about. Is that kind of true? Or okay. I think the talking to each other about this and saying to your husband, you know, I don't like the word that you said, comply. Ooh, how did that feel when you said that?
No, I mean, it's pretty much how I feel. It doesn't feel good, but that's definitely the case where it's complying for it. I mean, that's how I feel about it. It's more of there's no desire, so it's kind of like my wifely duty type of thing. And I mean, it becomes that way in a sense, and you know. It's partly due to our religious background and things like that, but it's very, sometimes it's hard for me to, because he gets upset to talk about it.
And the religious background, I'm not asking you what it is by any means, but what does that religious background say? What's the rule that...
that, you know, the women... should that women should I guess comply with their husband's desires and needs, you know, to support their husband in every way. And so that is something that I struggle with, but
sure.
I think it's more the physical aspect for me that I just don't have it in me, and it's very difficult to communicate that to him because he gets upset.
Well, I don't know if it's possible for you. Many times with a therapist, and especially a sex therapist, someone who has been trained in sexual behavior, I think many times that communication can start to happen. But you said physical. What you said physically with you, what does that mean?
My libido is low, so
okay.
I guess... that's pretty much what I mean. I don't really have that, like, sexual desire as I did earlier on, when I was in my 20s.
What's your age,
Rick?
Oh, in your 40s. That's the hottest time for women. That can be wonderful.
Right, and that is probably another thing for him. It's like, you're supposed to be at your sexual prime, but you're not, and you haven't been, and so it's kind of confusing for him.
Well, it's confusing for you, too, because you're feeling shame and resentment, and there's something, you all are not talking to each other really about this, and I do think a therapist could be very helpful, but if you could talk to him that you feel you have to comply, that if he could do this or that for you, it would be helpful. There's an old joke about what turns women on, and it shows a picture of a man vacuuming and holding a baby, you know, helping out in the house or understanding, and I'm just wondering if that's the case.
That could be the case for sure, but I think for me it's more of a it's more of an emotional thing, and the emotional desire that isn't there anymore. I'm not sure, but I still love him dearly.
Oh, then you can get it back.
That's really good to hear.
Well, you can. If you love him dearly and he loves you dearly, you can get back together and start talking about this. And he really should listen and bend a little bit, knowing that women just aren't sex objects. Women, you start, please believe me, the head and the heart. And once that's satisfied, then the other kind of flows. And plus, you know, is he doing things that turn you on? And you might want to figure out what does turn you on and what excites you and, you know, your romantic fantasies, what that is, and tell him, because it'll help both of you.
Right.
Cindy, this is Dr. Jenkins. I have a question. What is your sex drive and sex life when you're both on vacation, no kids on your trip, and you're just out on a boat or having a good time? Are you more conducive at that time?
It's definitely more, I'm more open to it, but I'm still a little more, I'm not as adventurous, I guess I would say, as he is. And so there's still a disconnect as far as our levels of libido and just that fire.
Right. Well, you know, and sometimes in the world, life is so complicated because, you know, you may have kids that have to be taken care of and all your things that go through to make the house work, and you may be both working, so it gets real complicated. That's why I was asking, I wonder what it's like when you have nothing to think about except each other.
We really haven't had that experience in a very long time, and then also it's come to a point where we're both like, that's our main focus is our kids, and you know, our daily mind that we have, and so it's a little, I mean, there's spark or that romance isn't there, but it's definitely like, we both love each other very much, and we are, you know, relatively happy. It's just the fact that it's so difficult to come together at like that symbiotic place that people need. And I read about it and I see it, or I think at least the people that I'm around have it. And, you know, we live in a community where it's pretty closed doors and stuff, so not a lot of communication about it, but...
But believe me, you're not alone. I promise you that. Cindy, I want to say one thing to you.
Yeah.
If you take nothing from this show, and I hope you can take some things, we're going to be on every week. I want you to take 30 minutes a day for you and your husband to look at each other, touch each other, and talk. Touch your hands, you know, and just talk. Say, let's work through this. We really want to do that. Communicate. That will start the conversation. So that's the one simple thing. Can you do that, do you think?
Yes. No, yes. Definitely for our marriage, yes.
For you.
Yeah.
For you.
For me too, yeah.
You deserve that. You totally do.
And Cindy, can you give us a call back next week?
Sure.
We'd like to have an update.
Okay.
Oh, boy, we've got you on. I think that's a great idea. Please do. Please call us and see if that worked. But promise that you'll do that 30 minutes every single day.
Okay.
No cell phones. All right.
Okay.
Good luck. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. So here you are with the Doc and Doc Show. We've had a great time. We feel good. We hope you do. So we're here at KHTS 1220. And please give us a call and think of your questions. See what you would like Dr. Jenkins and I to talk about. We would love to see you. And guess what? We're going to be here next week. So we wish you love, great sex, and happiness.
This is Dr. Gregory Jenkins of Newhall, California, and I'm sitting here with Judith Kurtz of Valencia, California. Dr. Kurtz and I are here to help you with some of your issues with stresses and sexuality and even plain medical questions. Dr. Kurtz is located in Valencia Boulevard, but you can get a hold of us each week at the same time here, and the phone number is 661-298 5487. We're on KHTS 1220 AM. So please call us back next week. We're going to have questions, so please call, and we enjoyed this hour. Thank you very much.
Thank you.